Here we're going to describe what the energy balance looks like for a stirred tank reactor. And we're going to do first a general balance. So this will be an unsteady state tank. And the idea is we have a feed coming in where F is the molar flow rate of component I, multiple components flowing in, and zero, that's the inlet value, and T zero is the temperature coming into the stirred tank reactor. The flow rate leaving should be different because we're carrying out a reaction, so for each of the components. The temperature likewise is different depending on how much heat transfer takes place, as whether we run it adiabatically or isothermally. And then the concentrations leaving, and I put these down because inside the reactor we should have the same temperature and the same concentration, because we're assuming this is completely well mixed. There's no gradients within the reactor. So as we add the feed, it undergoes a step change in temperature. V is the volume of the contents of the reactor. And N sub I is the number of moles of component I in the reactor. Now, to make things simpler and so we can better understand the process here, we're assuming constant heat capacity values, heat capacity for each component. We're also going to ignore kinetic energy and potential energy. We're going to assume those are negligible, which is a pretty good assumption for lots of chemical reactors. Now, we're going to also assume that we have no phase changes. Well, this is an assumption that may or may not be a good one, because there are certainly reactors in which feed is a liquid and some product leaves as a vapor. And then we'd have to take phase changes into account. But to understand the energy balances first, we'll do the simpler case with no phase changes. The other notation we should be aware of, I'm going to use T sub R as a reference temperature, and you'll see why we're doing that. We're going to assume we have some jacket around the tank for heat transfer, and we're going to assume there's a coolant temperature and the flow is high enough that that doesn't change. Otherwise, we could also write an energy balance for the coolant. And now if we look at the energy balance, the first term is a change in energy within the tank. So this is number of moles in the tank of each component, right? We're doing the summation over each component. This is heat capacity, and this derivative of the temperature in the tank with time, because we're looking at unsteady state systems, that temperature is going to change with time. And that's going to be equal then to terms for flow in and flow out. So let me first write the energy flow in. This is the molar flow rate of component I. Multiple components will be flowing in general. Of course, heat capacity again. And then let me correct this. So the feed temperature minus our reference temperature. Our reference temperature is going to be arbitrary, and we'll see how we can pick it to make the equation perhaps easier to deal with. We also have a flow out term. This again, molar flow rate, but this is the molar flow rate leaving, right? So this is moles per time, heat capacity. This is now the temperature within the reactor, which is identical to the temperature leaving. The next term is the heat reaction term. This is heat of reaction, or enthalpy change of reaction, per mole of reactant A. This is the rate of formation of A. If A is reactant, this term is going to be negative, and this then is the volume. All right, so this rate of reaction, we'll see this is something like minus a rate constant times concentration to the first power. So this is the heat reaction at temperature TR, at that reference temperature, since heat reaction in general can be dependent on temperature. Well, the other two terms that would show up would be heat transfer, in this case, heat exchange between the coolant that's flowing around the outside of the tank, and then work being added to the system. Well, work may be quite small, but we do have a stirrer that can input some work. In many cases, that's pretty small compared to heats of reaction. But if we have a very viscous solution, it's certainly possible that the work could be significant. So this is the energy balance. The only other term that we might want to define would be that Q dot would be a heat transfer coefficient, area for heat transfer, and I'm going to define it this way, temperature minus coolant temperature. So if the coolant temperature is lower than a reactor temperature, we're removing heat. This is the area for heat transfer, and this is a heat transfer coefficient. This equation then simplifies for different types of reactors. The general equation I've written would be for the startup of a continuous stir tank reactor. If we are running at steady state CSTR, then this first term would be zero. This term would be zero for steady state CSTR. If instead we're running a batch reactor, then the energy flow terms in and out would be zero, and we would have the change in energy of the tank related to heat reaction Q and W. And if we ran a semi-batch reactor, then perhaps there's energy flow in, but not energy flow out, so we might end up crossing out one of these terms, just depending on how the system's set up. There could be no energy flow in, but there could be energy flow out, for example. So if we start with this general energy balance, then we can derive the energy balance for batch, semi-batch, and steady-state CSTRs. And what I'm going to do is just write down the simplified equations here. So here are the equations, batch reactor. We've taken out the flow terms. A steady state CSTR, we've taken out the derivative term. Now, if I pick the reference temperature equal to the feed temperature, then it simplifies, and we only have the flow out term. And you can look at this energy balance is if we carry out the reaction at temperature T0, and this would be the energy, and then we took the products and heated them from T0 to T, you know, it was adiabatic, all that energy would go into heating up the products from the feed temperature to the exit temperature. And the semi-batch reactor is just a direct repeat of the one steady state CSTR, because it depends on which terms are zero in the semi-batch as to which terms we cross out.